Investors, meantime, still on guard for any wider fallout after the failure of New York-based investment fund Archegos Capital. The losses to global financial firms are still being tallied up, but the feeling right now is that damage has been contained. Two of the fund's biggest holdings, ViacomCBS and Discovery, are higher pre-market after another day of selling pressure on Monday. Relief that the Archegos saga hasn't turned into anything more significant helped boost Asian stocks today. Europe is mostly higher too, with the German DAX hitting fresh records. Let's get on this in our drivers. Claire Sebastian joins me now. Claire, great to see you. It was interesting to see how all this played out yesterday. Apparently not anything wider as far as those broader implications for the market, but lots of questions still. How was this able to happen? Do we know how Archegos bypassed regulations in the U.S.?
Yeah, Allison, still a lot of questions. I think short-term major fallout might have been averted, but as you say, bigger questions. And one of them is, what will this mean for the sort of prime broker credit desks at the banks? Are they going to be feeling a little less generous towards hedge funds? And what will that mean for the markets going forward if these firms can't rack up the kind of leverage that we saw at Archegos Capital? I will say that we've heard for the first time from that company. We have a statement from them this morning. They say via a spokesperson, this is a challenging time for the family office of Archegos Capital Management, our partners and employees. All plans are being discussed as Mr. Wang, who's the founder and head of that family office, and the team determine the best path forward. So not saying a lot, but interesting that they are breaking their silence at this moment, because of course it took a little while for Wall Street and all the experts to uncover who actually was behind this major fire sale of stocks on Friday. And I think that's part of what you're alluding to there, the questions around how they were able to rack up these kinds of holdings, significant holdings in certain companies without anyone really knowing about it.
Yeah, another burning question is Bill Huang himself, who in 2012 pleaded guilty to using insider information to trade Chinese bank stocks with another company. How was it that investment banks didn't blacklist him? How was it that he was able to just jump into another firm and trade again?
Well, we know that he was briefly sort of off the books at Goldman Sachs, but then apparently they allowed him back and were lending to him. You know, it's really not clear. It's very murky at this point, Allison. That was, you know, a fairly significant set of charges back in 2012. The fine was in the region of $44 million. So, and, you know, relatively not that long ago, within the past decade. But, you know, under a new firm, a family office, he was able to use what's called total return swaps, complex financial instruments to leverage these holdings that he had in the market. And I think this will spark further questions going forward, especially as we continue to be in this sort of rock bottom interest rate environment where lending is so easy.
Christina Hooper joins me now. She is the chief global market strategist at Invesco. Great to see you.
Good to be on. Thanks for having me.
All right, let's start with Archegos and the impact of its massive margin call over the past couple of days. You know, it seems to be limited so far to a handful of stocks. I want to hear from you, what does this tell you about the excessive risk-taking happening in not just the broader market, you know, with hedge funds and SPACs, but, you know, in digital assets too?
Well, I think the takeaway is that there is always, no matter what kind of market environment we're in, there is always risk-taking going on. And we have to recognize that some of the greatest risks are ones we don't even realize, those black swans. This is no different than some of the other events that have occurred in the recent past that have shaken investor confidence temporarily and created volatility, such as the Reddit GameStop stock debacle that occurred just a few months ago.
Let's talk about higher yields, because that's certainly a factor that's been driving where stocks have been going. Specifically, the pace of the yield is really, I think, what is making investors unnerved on the 10-year treasury. How high do you think it's going to go over the next 12 to 18 months?
Oh, I think the 10-year yield, even in just the next few months, could get to that 2% level. when we look out at the next 12 to 18 months, it could certainly go higher than that, getting closer to that 3% level, although I would expect it to come down somewhat, right? Because this is about expectations around a strong rebound in economic growth tied to the reopening of the economy. And that isn't likely to last a very long time, but it should be a powerful burst when it happens.
Love it or hate it, Wall Street watches the Fed for cues. Jay Powell has pretty much acknowledged that the Fed is going to be behind the curve where inflation is concerned. And he seems to be okay with that. But do you think that's the right strategy, to act only after we see those yields go up and, the Fed just sits on the sidelines?
I think it is the right strategy, just given that we have a multi-decade history of being in a very low inflation environment. And that's really what the Fed is counting on, that longer term trends hold, like demographics, like innovation. And that all suggests that if we do see an increase in inflation, it will truly be transitory, and therefore the Fed won't have to act. So that's the strategy, and it seems like a pretty sound strategy right now, even though investors aren't necessarily trusting the Fed on this one.
Okay, but rising interest rates have certainly spooked tech investors. We've seen tech stocks really take it on the chin. Do you think the FANG trade is over?
I don't think the FANG trade is over the longer term, right? I don't think tech, I don't think innovation is over the long run either. But they are higher valuation names in general. And so they need to adjust to higher rate levels. And so every time we see an increase in the 10-year yield, especially when it's on the faster side, as we've seen recently, that creates a period of digestion primarily for those higher valuation names like technology. However, for a long-term investor, it does represent a tactical buying opportunity.
Okay, we are right around the corner from a new quarterly earnings season. I want to hear what you're expecting to hear from companies as far as pressures on their revenue and profit.
So I would actually expect to see improved confidence in the outlook. So we may not get great earnings reports. I think companies have been very good at, have learned to manage earnings expectations well. So I think we'll see the majority of companies, as we've seen in past quarters, meet or beat expectations. But what I'm particularly interested in is their outlook for the rest of the year. We're seeing business confidence growing. Anecdotally, what we're hearing is companies very excited about this reopening, expecting it to be very powerful. And so I would expect that to filter into comments, into projections about earnings later this year. And I think in general, what we'll see is quite positive sentiment.
Very quickly, do you expect the bond market to react to the legislative push for a sweeping infrastructure plan here in the U.S.?
I do think we will see some reaction, but we have to recognize that the bond market reacts to a variety of different factors, including growth expectations and inflation expectations. And I would argue that it is more being driven right now by growth expectations as opposed to inflation expectations, mm-hmm. but they're all wrapped into any kind of stimulus packages that we're talking mm-hmm. about.
All right, Christina Hooper, thanks so much. Chief Global Market Strategist at Invesco. Great talking with you.